All right. Wonderful. I'm feeling great. I hope you are too. And we're on the first tee here, right? We're just hanging out. As the weather clears in California, we're headed for some gorgeous spring weather. And I'm ready. I am ready. It's all going really, really well here. Surviving the intensity of it all, and hitting the deadlines, reaching the goals, continuing to do that. So as we just hang out here in humility, which is the whole key to your success, everyone's success on the spiritual path, the humility is the leverage that we need and use in the wow practice. Okay, so whatever our goals are, it should be, it has to be actually, we have no choice, it has to be the peace of God, it has to be. So we have to get there, no choice about it. Anyone who thinks they have a choice is just being foolishly arrogant, actually. There's no choice at all. We cannot change what we are, so we have no choice but to accept this fact. But we have a familiarity bias towards doubt and against certainty. So we still doubt the truth that we can't change ourselves. So we keep trying to pretend evidence that we can, which are the bodies, this world, the universe. It's all pretend evidence that we can change what we are. And fixate the mind. Fixate the hallucination of the absence of God, which is not possible. Not possible. The mind is absolutely free. So we have to get to the peace of God. How do we do that? We get there through a very, very great practice, the wow practice. It's really the ultimate practice because we start out with humility, saying, I'm going to get knocked. I'm going to get knocked down when I during this practice. There's no doubt that the brilliant clarity of my mind, of the one mind, is going to peek out behind the clouds and just knock me out. Knock me down. So knock me down. Like a boxer. I'm using the analogy of a boxer. It's a really, really great analogy. I used to watch boxing when I was younger, and I noticed that the really wise boxers, if they ever got knocked down, they would stay down. They'd accept it, and they wouldn't try to jump right back up. They'd take as long as they could, you know, 8, 9, and then get up at just before 10, and then immediately cover up and go back to their corner on the ropes or something to recover. So they humbly accept it. Oh my gosh, I've just been knocked down. Wow, okay, I need to recover. That's what they would do. Whereas the foolish ones would try to jump right back up as soon as possible, and they're like staggering around like, hey, I didn't get knocked down, you know, I slept, and then boom, you know, they get hit again and they're knocked out. it's like a beautiful analogy for what we're doing, because what we do is the boxer we're boxing with is our own brilliant clarity, and when it shows itself, we're going to be shocked. In other words, knocked down onto the canvas. We expect it. In fact, we prepare for it here. We say, okay, let's stay humble and say, you know what? I've just been knocked down. Why? Because it exceeds our expectations. It always, the appearance of what we really are, our brilliant, clear freedom, is always going to knock us down. Exceed our expectations. Ultimately, we will get to the end of practice, ultimately. Okay, but along the way, it's going to exceed our expectations, and this, to melt them down, just absolutely go beyond them, and this causes what's called a knockdown. The, you know, wow. Well, the wow is a way to stay on the canvas. When we're knocked down, so let's just stay there. Let's get up real slowly. Let's go back to our corner and make sure we don't get knocked out. Getting knocked out means panicking. If you try to jump up too fast and just keep on trucking, you know, when you get this brilliant dawning of truth in your mind, directly within your own mind, which is the most powerful witnessing there is. It's way better than looking at pictures of saints and quotes and reading spiritual books. That stuff cannot compare with actually experiencing it for yourself within your own mind, within the mind, directly within. It carries such certainty with it, right? So when that happens, our expectations get shocked. And so we don't know how to function. We don't know how to meet our expectations anymore. So that's why we need to be committed to non-action. We're humble and committed to non-action to start off the practice. That's how we start off. We're going to be very humble. So the wow just slows us down from getting up. Let's just get our, you know, let the shock wear off. Let the shock wear off. And once it wears off, we're back feeling fine again. So humility and humility to start off the practice and non-action, commitment to non-action. That's how we start. That's the key. And then the third part, of course, is full stop in the wow. Absolutely stop in the wow. Just say, okay, I'm shocked right now. I'm in shock. I don't know what to do because my expectations have just vanished, so to speak. I don't know what my expectations are. So I don't know how to function. How do I know how to function if I don't have any expectations? We're not there yet, okay? We don't have to figure that out. So, we look at the wow now. The wow, once we've been knocked down by our own brilliant clarity, we use the wow so we don't panic. We stay down. And we do that by choosing neither truth nor lies. Okay? Neither certainty nor doubt. We don't choose either one. We choose wow. We choose wow. We don't affirm nor deny. We neither affirm nor deny the truth. We just go into the sort of neutral state, but it's not really neutral. We're affirming wow, actually. We're affirming wow. Like, wow. But we're not choosing between truth and lies. We're just choosing wow. And this enables us to calm down. So we don't get greedy here. When we get knocked down, well, to bring in one more factor is we're proactive about the wow. In other words, when we get brilliant clarity dawns upon us, as it will, when we're humble, it will dawn upon us. When we prepare this way, it will always dawn upon us. Something will happen that will just be knock us down. But what we do, we're proactive. When we realize, wow, I've just been hit hard by this, we don't wait for panic to set in. We don't wait. We cap it right there. We don't search for more answers. We don't say, oh my gosh, I'm almost enlightened. If I just push a little harder, I might get it. Okay, we don't do that. We cap our expectations immediately and say, wow, this is shocking. I'm going to go choose the wow right now. And so we stop even trying to search our mind for truth at that point. This is really, really important. And this segues really into the golf analogy I'm using. I'm using sports analogies here. Golf analogy is that, how do you build up confidence in golf? It is avoid losing it, for one thing. You avoid losing confidence. And so if you hit a great shot, you're full of confidence. You say, okay, I'm going to hit another one. And you hit a terrible one, and suddenly the one that you hit great, now you've completely forgotten about it. Like it never happened, and now you're just down in the dumps. Same thing spiritually. You just have this brilliant experience of clarity in your mind, and you're so confident, say, oh my gosh, that's tremendous. And then you push for some more, and you flounder. You can't figure it out. Your whole mind goes into confusion, you're floundering, and you totally forget about that good feeling of how wonderful it was, that brilliant clarity. You totally forget about it. This is stupid, right? It's really, yeah, we have to avoid that. So this is, again, the wisdom of this practice, is you cap it with that one breakthrough. Stop right there. Stop right there. Don't go any further. And let that just settle in, like, gosh, I am really, really, really making progress. This is tremendous. Don't take the second step. Just take one step at a time. And then stop it. So I've been doing this for quite some time. Just tremendous insights. And then I just say, wham, okay, that's it. And they go right in the well. I'm not saying it's true or false. I'm just stopping everything and just focusing on the wow. I choose wow. Everything is wow. Wow, wow. This is wow, wow, wow. And I block all reactions, all thinking in this way. And what this does is your nerves get to settle down. And then it builds confidence. You don't lose that feeling within you of like, you know, I'm doing just great. So I liken that to golf, in that I say you should play best ball. And with someone who's not so good, when they hit a good shot, you don't play from their good shot next, because what if they hit a bad shot the next shot, which is quite likely, actually, when you're not so good, hitting two good shots in a row doesn't happen very often. You say, no, we'll hit from my ball. And so if we mess up from my ball, that's not messing up your shot, your drive, at all. So you build confidence in that way. You don't risk your success. You do not risk your success. So more and more and more and more, the clarity about this practice is coming in. And it's just fabulous, the wisdom behind it. And sometimes it will be more effective than other times. If you know, depending, sometimes it'll just be mega breakthroughs, and then you'll calm down from one, another one will come. Calm down from that, another one will come, like sets of waves, like, and you just, but you just stick with the program. You cap your expectations. Okay, non-action. I will not act because I don't know what my expectations are right now. So I'm committed to non-action. Now, along those lines, I've been talking about the difference between the female pretend appearance and the male pretend appearance, because really our bodies are just pretend appearancing, evidence of fixation, pretend evidence of fixation. There's a big difference between the two in terms of how they function mentally, because of a vast cultural experiencing and the way it's all set up here. And But one practice that I noticed is, for instance, the practicing of non-action. If you want to really get into the wow practice, I would recommend practicing non-action, and you're pretending in your mind non-action. I did a lot of this, and I used to say, you know, even if Jesus Christ shows up here and says, come on, we got to save the world, I'd say, Jesus, I'm committed to non-action. I'm not budging. I'm practicing. And that's higher than you. Our practice is the highest, actually. You have to put your practice above everything else. Okay, everything else. Even the Dharma Kings. You're practicing this. Nobody can interfere. Even if the Dharma Kings ask you, say, hey, you know, let's talk. Say, nope, I'm in the wow, so I'm committed to no action right now. So we can practice this in many ways. You have to imagine it in your mind. But I came up with one for the female pretend appearances, which spirit is pretending. This pretend appearance we call female, pretend appearance we call male. And if you're the spirit pretending an appearance of a female, here's a great way to practice non-action and see how you do. And you have to prove to yourself you can do this. Just imagine that you're in the wow and committed to non-action, and your child starts crying, your baby starts crying. Okay, there's something wrong. Something they're very irritated. You know, children, babies, and they're screaming for you or something. And yet you can't budge. You don't budge. You don't budge for anything. And you have to find something that just causes you enormous consternation and put yourself through those ordeals like that. Search for something that just really says, I just got to respond, and then refuse to do so. And as you do that, you will strengthen yourself. It's like a workout. So I've done a lot of that. A lot of that is a workout. Now, the only caveat to all this is, if there is a genuine crisis and your child is being mauled by a pit bull or something, immediately you take a break from the practice and respond to it. But in your imagination, you can practice anything you want. You can practice your house is burning down. You know, you're sitting in the garden with a wild practice and your entire house is burning down. You don't budge. You don't budge. Even if the whole world were burning down, you don't budge. So this is a great way to practice. And you know, men can practice. The baby thing is probably the toughest one. That's a great way for the female pretend appearancing to practice in terms of to feel the intensity of it, the pull of the world, really. Or some might be like a dog, and the dog's like squealing, I'm hurt, like, oh, something's wrong. And we thought, oh my God, I gotta go help the animal, you know. And just say, no. No matter what happens, I'm not moving from this spot. Now, for men, male pretend appearance, it could be many, many different things, right? But we could use the traditional one, like the most beautiful woman in the world comes, like Radha is coming to Krishna. Let's use Krishna's example. Krishna's meditating. It's in the wow. Non-action. And Radha comes along and says, oh, Krishna, you know, I've been searching for you for eons, and I finally found you, my love, you know. And Krishna just doesn't move at all. She goes, come with me, let us walk together through the enchanted forest, and we shall be blissfully happy forever after. Krishna doesn't budge, you know, doesn't even budge. And she says, and she starts to fade away. She says, Krishna, I'm going to lose you forever. I'm going to lose you forever. Please. She's pleading, you know. Doesn't budge. See? But really imagine some situation, some scenario that just absolutely digs into your nerves and challenges you to the utmost. And you just don't budge. And I mean, I've been through this, and you just feel shaking. You're shaking. You're trembling. And the intensity is just the burn, like, oh, I've got to do something. And you refuse to move, and your whole body feels like it's almost burning. It's so amazing. Call it the burn. And when you get through this, that you feel you've just completed this ordeal successfully. So the more ordeals you complete successfully, the more confidence you get in yourself. And you realize, hey, I can do this. I can put myself through ordeals and get through them. And then you begin to be the guru of your practice, because you're building confidence. So let's see that suddenly you see there's no death. Okay, well, no action. I just sit here quietly, like nothing's happened. I don't go running out and say, hey folks, there's no death. I just sit here. No action. Committed to non-action. And I see what death is, and I see what decay is. It's all, I won't say what it is at this point, but I have seen it. And I said, okay, and right away, full stop in the wow, right there, capped it right there. So I'm not gonna go any further. I see death decay, so simple, so easy. Okay, just cap it and build confidence. Don't dig, don't say, oh great, I discovered this. Now I probably be able to finish now. You know, let me really use this to dig even deeper. No, I immediately say, no, that's enough. I'm not gonna go any deeper than that. Realizing this is extremely profound already. You see, don't get greedy. Don't get greedy. And I'll say, you know, just I'll let it sit, I'll build confidence, and down the road, I'll see it even more clearly, for sure. But right now, that was good enough. It was quite shocking. Quite shocking. Ah, my back. Rickety click. Okay. I ran yesterday, first time. Wonder of wonders, my knee feels fine today. I don't, you know, how can I explain it except I committed to what God wants me to do, and then suddenly my knee has felt well. Ever since then, I had a feeling, that's it. I said, okay, God, we'll do it your way. I'll go play golf. That's what you want me to do? That's what I'll do. And suddenly my knee has felt well since then. And it's just amazing, isn't it? When I was trying to do what God didn't want me to do, the knee hurt so bad I couldn't do it. Now that I'm willing to do what God wants me to do, the knee feels great. That's the truth. So, you know, I took it that way. I said, you know, if I could just commit to what I'm supposed to do, I know my health is going to be great, will be great. Now, my back is a little sore right now because I swang golf clubs today very strongly. Oh, man. And that was amazing, too. My knee didn't hurt at all. And I finally tried the full swing with the driver in the power, my power swing, which I felt may have hurt my knee in the first place. It puts a lot of torque on it, but and I was able to do it, and it was like great. I said, "Oh my gosh, I got my power swing. It's here." Holy cow, that is really something. Both a forward and driver. I just practicing a swing, not hitting a ball, but just practice swing, and I was able to just full on, and the swing felt great. Looked great, felt great. I said, wow, I've got it. So for me, that's really huge news, because it shows faith in God. When God showed me that power swing, Longchenpa helped me with his power swing, it was months ago. And before I hurt my knee? It must be quite a few months ago. And then I realized, okay, this swing is going to work for me, but I've got a lot of work to do to strengthen myself and other stuff. And I haven't tried it even since. I haven't tried it since. But I said, when I'm ready, when everything else is ready, I'll be able to do this. And that happened today. So it's very, very helpful in building confidence when you have faith in God, when you cap what you're doing and said, you know, okay, I'll get back to that, but I'm going to work on some other stuff to strengthen myself. And then later on, you get back, and just like God said, promised, it's still there. You still have it, and it's better than ever, and you're feeling great. And say, holy cow, playing it really smart that way. And I found the swing again, and I did it. I said, oh, gosh, yeah. That really, really works. I found a swing that really works for the driver months and months ago. But I put it in the mothballs because my knee started hurting. I did other stuff. And I was wondering, can I find it again? Yeah, I found it. And I can tell, because before, I never hit the ball as well in my life. I just found this swing, and it just works for me. It just works. So, really good news. I feel, you know, way more confident now, in all the way around, all the way around. God wants me to go play golf. And that's what I'll do. He'll figure it out somehow for me. He'll make it happen for me. As long as I, you know, do my part. And it's odd. Today, an acquaintance, a good acquaintance that I've known for quite some time, he sort of accused me of something that I didn't do. And he was sure. He said, no, I'm sure it was you. I'm sure it was you. And you did this, and you need to tell, you know, like, I said, no, I don't know what you're talking about. And he's like, looked at me like, kind of in a, you know, like, huh, weird look. And I was kind of uncomfortable. I was like, what the heck's going on? I've never seen him act so weird. And unfortunately, the guy that was waiting on me, he just said, he brushed it off. Said, just he looked at me and said, no, brush it off. Forget it. You know, he's just in an erratic mood right now. So I said, yeah, thanks. Okay. He was. Somehow his mood flipped into a sort of a paranoid, accusatory mood towards me. And I'm just like, what the heck's going on? I don't even know what he's talking about. He's saying that I did this and this and I had to. I said, I don't even know what you're talking about. I didn't do anything like that. And I was really like saying, wow, God was showing me something. He also showed me this homeless man today. It's very important. It's parked on a left turn lane, and we're all stopped there. Not parked, we're stopped, waiting for the light to turn green. And there's a homeless man there with a sign, you're homeless, I'm homeless and hungry. So I reached in my wallet, got it out, got him a dollar, and said, hey, come here. And he saw me, and then he walked towards the car. I gave him a dollar. And then he walked back to the front of the line where he was sitting by the light and sat down. And then he folded up his sign. And I'm thinking, what the heck is going on? What is with this guy? And I motioned to him. I said, you got to be walking down the line of cars. I mean, they can't get out. What do you expect them to get out of their car and walk to you? How are you going to get any money when you're sitting at the front of the line? And when the light turns green, all the cars are going to be going past you. They can't give you money then, unless you're me, I throw it out the window. But when they're stopped, you have to walk down the line from car to car to car and show them the sign. And that puts pressure on them. And then, you know, some will give you some money. You get enough money to eat something. But no, all he did was he took my dollar and then sat down like he was happy. Like, that's it. I said, wow, man, I don't know what's going on. And so I passed him, and I waved to him, you know, and he said, oh yeah, he's smiling, waved to me. And I said, what a fool. What's going on with this? But later on, I started putting everything together and saying, oh my gosh. God's saying, don't go searching and pressing people at this time, you know, to help them. Don't say, hey, maybe you'd be interested in this. Hey, maybe you would be interested in this. Hey, maybe you're interested. I could do that, like on Facebook. Just, you know, you just friend like hundreds and hundreds of people and say, hey, you should do the WOW practice. God says, don't do that. Don't do that right now. Because my acquaintance friend just flipped out on me. Started getting a paranoid, accusatory attitude out of the blue. And it never happened before. What the heck? And then God said, do you remember how this world, this is the way, with that dream you had when you were captured and held hostage by this world, and they were ready to let you go, and suddenly they turned paranoid and said, no, you can't go? And I said, oh yeah, that is right. So, and something else came up, moods can flip in an instant, actually. They can flip in an instant here in this world. And this is what God is telling me, this is what's going to happen. This is the quality of this world. Everything can seem fine here, and the people can seem reasonable and rational. But suddenly, they panic, and they become paranoid. These are called psychotic. It's a psychosis. Everyone here is psychotic, actually. And so they may seem to be friendly and nice, but you realize there's something isn't quite right with them. Not quite. You say, they're not totally stable, actually, but they're putting on a good, they're trying to be stable, and they're doing a good job. But then suddenly that instability roars to the surface, you know, so overwhelms them. They're overwhelmed by insecurity, and they turn paranoid. And that's, I had this, you know, this tremendous dream a while back that I explained several times about how I was trying to get free of this world I was in, and was being held hostage, and they kept telling me they were going to release me, and every time I started to walk away, they suddenly panicked and grabbed me and said no, and they put me back into captivity. This happened over and over and over and over, but until finally they released me and said, and asked me to promise them to go to the Dharma Kings and get help for them, which I have done. But so there's actually this world, and that's the nature of the mind in its attempt to fixate, hallucinate the absence of God. It's very insecure, and it has defenses against this insecurity. And when enough of those defenses somehow fail, they can suddenly become very irrational and paranoid, and turn on their friends, turn on those who are here to help them, and accuse them and scapegoat them. It's called scapegoating. And I'm certainly, God has told me to be very, very aware of this. So God's saying this is going to happen coming up. And so I need to make myself scarce. Go play golf. And so I won't be scapegoated. You know, it's not the right time to get involved with a bunch of people right now. Because anyone at all in the world could suddenly turn on you in this world, turn on you out of this deep-seated, you know, insecurity and the resultant fear and paranoia, and suddenly, and I know what paranoia is like. I've certainly went through a phase. I experienced it when I was going through all these mental phases, experiencing all the different states of mind, the troublesome states of mind. And so I went through a paranoid phase. I was just observing it. So this is very interesting. It was terrible. Really terrible. And so I know what it is you simply, when you become paranoid, you think that everyone's out to get you, and especially your friends, because those are the ones that you feel most closest to. And so you feel that they naturally get close to you, right? Like, hey, how you doing? Stuff. And so when you're paranoid, you want everybody to stay away from you. So those you don't know, you're not so worried about. It's the ones you do know that cause you the most fear, especially your best friends. And you say, I think my best friend's coming over to see me today. I'm afraid they're gonna shoot me, you know. What do? I got to get a gun. I got to protect myself. You know, paranoia is like that. So paranoia is usually turned towards your closest friends. Okay, that's true. I said, oh boy. So, I have to help, you know, in some way, but certainly protect myself from this. It's coming. It's building. It's building in the world here. And again, you don't know when it's going. I don't know when it's going to happen, but God knows for sure. For sure. Now, my swings today were great. I mean, I was on balance. Really, really, really good swings. I said, wow, God, and my knee feels fine. I mean, I felt great. My body feels fine. I said, hey, you know, God, I'm feeling like we can go golfing, right? This is shaping up very nicely, actually. So I'm not going to get ahead of myself, but I'm just letting them know, hey, I'm fit. I feel like I was 170. I mean, I feel like I can move around really well. I mean, everything is clicking right now. So if you're like a spiritual teacher and people really trust you and they feel they can get close to you, when they become paranoid, you become, to them, the most dangerous person in the world. Suddenly, they say, oh my gosh, this person that I allow to get real close to me, that's where the danger is. Because what if they're out to get me? So they're not worried about other people. They're worried about you, the ones that are close to them, the teacher. And so the teachers are put in a very dangerous situation. When the world goes paranoid, very dangerous situation. And you know the paranoia is coming. it's so amazing stuff taking place in the world. It's just more of the same, same old, same old, same old. And you cannot reason with the paranoid. The more you try to reason with them, the more frightened they are of you. You just have to back off. You just have to back off and let it calm down. Let it calm down. That's all you can do. And at a distance, somehow you can give some help in certain ways, and they and eventually, you know, they burn out. It burns out. Paranoia burns out and wears off. But it's nasty paranoia. It really is. And you know, fortunately, I know exactly how it is. So, for a while, you just have to keep your distance. There's trying to help is pouring gasoline on their fire, because you're trying to get close to them to help out. They don't see it that way at all. Just the opposite. That you're like this treacherous person who's trying to get close to destroy them. Yeah, that's how they feel about it. So, just have to back off until they cool down. And later they'll tell you, yeah, I don't know, sorry, yeah, I didn't know what I was doing. And you don't want to interact with someone that way because they feel guilty later and ashamed. So if you just kind of stay away, then later on they'll say, oh, you know, yeah, I was just kind of went through a tough time there, and now I feel fine. And then you can be, you know, friends again and et cetera. So it's like it's best to just keep your distance. I discovered Facebook. I didn't know this. I've been looking for it. I don't even know how I discovered it. Facebook is so... I can't remember how the heck I did something. It's there's so many bells and whistles everywhere. Because I don't know how I'm going to go back and change it if I want to. But close friends. You're able to set a group to share with called close friends. I didn't know that before. Maybe I discovered it once before, but I forgot. But I found it again. I said, oh my gosh, so you can actually select close friends. And then choose your close friends that you want to share posts with. And then when you make a post, you can choose, who do you share this with? You can choose close friends. And then only they get your posts. And nobody else, it doesn't show up in anyone else's newsfeed, which doesn't clog up their newsfeed, for one thing, which is great. And I said, oh, that's very helpful, very useful. Not that I'm getting any responses on Facebook anymore from anyone, really. God's drying it up for me, really. It's quite amazing. And when God wants to help you out, he does. He just somehow blocks everyone from you. But this is a useful tool. It's a useful tool. I can maybe post on Facebook a bit, and not just post so all my friends in public see it. No, just close friends. Just those who are what I consider, you know, close friends who are pretty stable, you know, stable types. So another advancement that we'll see how helpful that is. It may be very helpful, actually. There's a lot going in the right direction here. A lot. Very auspicious. My confidence is growing, and how wise it is to not even hit any golf balls. I don't even hit any golf balls. I just keep doing the swing and get more and more confidence in my strength and swing and ability. And you go to a driving range, you're going to hit some bad balls until you dial it in there. But I say, I'm not going to spend any of the confidence that I've accumulated yet. I'm just going to keep accumulating it so I can withstand, you know, a few bad shots. I say, oh, that's okay, I'll dial it in, you know, like that. You got to be very careful with your confidence to make sure you keep building it up. And don't deplete it. Don't deplete your confidence. Sometimes it's best just don't even put it to the test. Just so you know, I know I can do this, and don't even put it to the test. And when the right moment comes, and then. You know, it'll happen that way. But don't force it. So, I'm just letting God know that, yeah, okay, God, let's do this. Let's do this. You're giving me some great, great, great help here and wisdom. Starting to accumulate wisdom. I realize, wow, this is very different than before. I'm seeing the world, how the living world, in a different way. How we can accumulate confidence and don't dissipate it is really important. So on the spiritual path, when we get this breakthrough, just say, you know what, that's good enough for now. Let me put that in the bank. And just keep putting it in the bank. Don't risk it. Don't double down on your success, okay, on the spiritual path. Don't double down. Like a gambler says, well, I just won that hand. Let me put all the money I won that hand, and I'll double down, and I'll double it here. And they keep doing that. Don't do that. When you have a great breakthrough, you just say, wow, that's a big treasure right there. That's enough for now. And I'm going to just stop at full stop in the wow, get through the shock of this, and I'm not going to try for anything more. Okay, that's so don't double down. Don't say, hey, I just had a great breakthrough. Maybe this is my lucky day. Let me see if I can really push another one through. Okay, that's what you must avoid, which is, so that's why I say you must avoid drugs in your spiritual practice, including caffeine, because that interferes with your capability to cap your expectations, to refuse to double down, to say that's enough. Because caffeine makes you feel abnormally confident in yourself and your intellect. And you will say, hey, you know what? This is my lucky day. I feel great right now. I'm on a roll. I think I can get the next insight, maybe a whole bunch more. And this is totally opposite of what you want to do. Because you'll end up ultimately absolutely floundering in confusion. You'll say, what happened? I had it, and now I feel so confused. I'm having a nervous breakdown. You know, this is exactly what happens. And from long, long, long experience, I know this to be so. So with no drugs in at all, it's easy, much easier to say, hey, okay, I'm not going to be greedy. I'm going to stop. Fine. You feel okay with that. You feel calm. That's it. You're able to do it. So the no drug policy is essential for this practice, absolutely essential, because this refusing to double down is part, you know, part of the core, forms part of this core of the of this practice. You cannot disregard this aspect of it. You must full stop in the wild, cap it, your success, cap it right then and there. And you will know, you say, you know what? It's time to cap it right now. And you refuse to use your mind in any way except to affirm, wow. Like, how do I, what am I going to do? Wow. How do I feel? Wow. What was the insight I just had? It was wow. Well, what am I going to do with this? Wow is what I'm going to do with it. You know, in every direction your mind tries to go, you say, wow is what I'm doing. I know what I'm doing. It's wow. I know what I'm thinking. It's wow. I know where I'm going. It's wow. Okay, so what's the next insight from this? Well, I already know. It's wow. I already got it. So I can relax. No, I don't need to make any effort or struggle at all. I've already got it, and it's wow. And so this pacifies yourself. You pacify your mind this way. You're able then to stop and let the shock wear off. And then after the shock is worn off, you'll feel this suddenly kind of release, like, oh, I'm okay, because I'm not going to panic. And then you may start to, you know, your mind, you'll see just how it goes with your mind. And who knows? Maybe another insight will come. But then you do the same with that one. Okay? So you don't try to force anything in this practice. You just stay committed to non-action. You stay humble, committed to non-action. Willing to wow whatever arises, and then just stay with it, and something will come up. It always does. It always does. Just as you're prepared to really be effective with this, make sure you don't panic. So again, I keep clarifying this practice for everyone, because it is so amazing, this practice, so successful. And I can see the elements why it's successful, and knowing how the mind works, and our familiarity, bias, continuity, fear, insecurities that we have, knowing how to get past all those and keep your path smooth. I keep my path very smooth, intense, but still smooth. Okay, it's very intense because I keep having more and more huge breakthroughs. And it's like sometimes you say, oh my gosh, you know, another one. Oh man. Oh, here we go again. And sometimes we want to take a little break. I kind of feel like that right now, actually. I'm kind of enjoying just letting my nerves settle down. I've had so many breakthroughs. I mean, every day, two or three huge pushes forward. I mean, just huge. Two or three, you know, it's, my gosh. And in different ways, God is aware of your whole life, the totality of what you're doing. I'm like, well, for today, another breakthrough. I realized no one is ever born. It's impossible to be born. How could freedom be born? We're freedom. How could freedom be born? It can never be born at all. No, nothing has ever been born. That is a fact. I saw it. So that was a big wow. It's like, oh my gosh, yeah. This is all just pretending. pretending, our imagination just pretending that we've been born, but we haven't. So we don't, you know, seeing that changes the whole perspective on everything, right? Your expectations. I was thinking, like, when was I born? I said, well, I was born when I was 12. Before I was 12, I didn't know I was born, but they convinced me I was born. So I lasted longer than most. But when we're young, we don't feel like we're born. We really don't. People keep telling us, you know, they're like, huh? What do you mean I'm born? How can freedom be born? But they tell you, no, this is your name. That's your birth name. You got to learn your birth name. This is your birth body and all this stuff. And the mind then identifies with this fable about being born. So I held out and I kept arguing, saying, no. And people got so mad at me. You're so crazy, contradictory. What do you mean? Your mother says she gave birth to you. You're bored. You know, you're a horrible person. What do you... You know, they were very perplexed by me. And then finally, I tried to accept, well, I guess I have been, you know, maybe I've been born, but I said, nah, you know, it's just, but I had to put up with it, like I got to eat this crow, you know, horrible tasting something. But now I'm going back, you know, and say, wait a minute, well, I was born when I was 12, no, but wait a minute, maybe I was never born, maybe I've never been born, and before I was 12, I was right that I'm not born, nobody's born, no one's ever been born. There's no such thing as birth. A pretend appearancing of a female has a pretend appearancing of a body being expelled from it, and have a pretend experiencing of that body changing in size, etc. But what does that have to do with spirit being born? Mind being born? It has nothing to do. Mind isn't born, it can't be born. Well, how could freedom, again, absolute perfect freedom, how can we possibly say that that has taken birth? Nothing takes birth. Okay, there's no such thing as birth. And apropos of that, Jesus says that God is totally unaware of this world and people and all of this. Totally unaware of it. Because God knows we're exactly as God created us. So God doesn't say, hey, look at the mind has taken birth in a world. No, he doesn't. God is not like that. God says, I know my son is perfect freedom. So God knows nothing of birth because birth has never taken place. God knows nothing of worlds because worlds have never taken place. I mean, worlds are supposedly the place where we take birth in. But if we cannot take birth, how can there be a world that we take birth in? How can a world be born? Worlds can't be born either. Nothing can be born. Nothing can be born. So it's just a fable of pretension. We're using all this stuff to pretend that we can fixate the mind, actually. But it's never happened. No one's been born. So that was a big insight today. I wowed that. Capped it. You know, say, okay, that's good. Let's just stop that right there. And once you go through the wow and you say everything is wow, and you pacify yourself and you say, I've got the answer. Don't worry, I've got it. It's wow. I've got my future actions. It's wow. I know what to do. It's wow. So I feel fine. Everything's fine. You pacify your mind that way. Then you realize you're out of the woods for as far as panic goes. Okay. But you want to kind of cool down, and you don't want to really dig back in. So you just start talking about something like the weather, you know, just some sort of, like, you know, blah, blah, blah. And, you know, right? I talk about my golf game. Let's talk about my golf game, right? It just helps you cool down. It just helps you relax. And, whew, you know, wow, that was intense. I don't want to go back to the intensity right now. So let's talk about something that's not so intense. So it's just, you know, chit-chat. That's helpful. Chit-chat is helpful. So that's why I do the chit-chat. That's part of the practice, actually. And just calm down. You just went through an ordeal. And again, you put that confidence in the bank. Don't put it to the test. Don't put the confidence you just accrued through going through an ordeal. Don't put it to the test. Refuse to put it through the test. You said you've already, you know, put it, wow, I already got it, put it to the test, wow, this is wow, everything is wow. and then later just talk about stuff that doesn't really, not that important, you know. Yeah, but you'll relay it back to spiritual wisdom, you know, as we do here. But we just keep it light, not so intense, until you know, really have fully feel recovered from the ordeal. So practice should be an ordeal. You should put yourself through an ordeal every day, maybe several times a day. But it's just like working out, going to the gym. I mean, when you go to a gym, don't you put yourself through an ordeal? Of course you do. Physical ordeal, but also mental and emotional. And so the spiritual practice is just like that. You put yourself through an ordeal. You work out. And it's how you get in good spiritual shape, good spiritual condition. Now, I could say more right now, but I feel no. You know, it's enough. It's enough for right now. Just let us calm down and not push it. Not push it. So you have to be very aware of how you feel, kind of in this intuitive way. Not what your sensations are, but just intuitively, do you feel like you're on the edge, like, okay, just keep it calm for now. Now, if I'm going to go play golf, I have to enjoy it. I mean, I don't want to just struggle with it and be a trauma ordeal. I want to feel like, you know, I get up to the tee. I know what my swing is. I know I'm going to, you know, crush it. And I know what my, you know, exactly, okay. Get up here, everything, you know, engage your core, you know, get your stability, you know, arms are out, so you've been a big swing, and you know, you're going to take it inside, wrap it around, and then just really push it through, and then come up to a high finish, and you know, sweep it like this. You just know what you're going to do, and you just do it. You don't fool around. You know, you're confident. You've got your game, and you just do it. And then, you know, so I'm feeling, you know, that way to some degree. We'll see. It's just I'm building up confidence, I might say, day by day, of just repeating it over and over and over. So it's just, yeah, okay, this is what I'm going to do. I know what I'm going to do. Then it makes it a lot easier. And you're not out there struggling to find your game. You know what your game is. You know what it's about. Just like spiritual practice. When you have a practice, it's so much easier. You know how to do it. And it's like night and day. Because if like in golf, if you don't have a game, and you don't know your game, and you're swinging everything, you're out of shape, and you're searching, so that didn't work, let me change it. And it happened. I mean, I've been through the ringer with that. You try like 10 different swings during the round, say, wait a minute, I just sliced that one, I got to change my swing entirely, let me change my stance this way or that way. And you just, after a while, you're just a wreck. You can't find anything. And it's hell. It's terrible. And you feel like quitting. I finally did quit. I said, this is ridiculous. I can't go on this way. So ultimately, you'll quit your spiritual path if you don't have a practice that you really have grooved. You gotta have to groove a practice to really, really make great headway. Have to groove a practice so you really know your game. And this requires a lot of work over and over and over. Just like the golf swing, every day, every other day, just keep working, even if it takes years. I mean, I've been working this almost 2 years now. And I say, you know, I'm not playing golf until I feel that I've got it grooved. You know, I really understand what it is that I want to do, and I can do it. So I'm not even going to play. Just practice. And I still feel that way. Yeah. God says, okay, you're ready. You know, I'm just like, okay, you know, here, all right, let's just do it like this and this, and here we go. But the swing right now, it felt very good. I mean, it was repeatable. I said, okay, yeah, this is just the way I want it to be. Just the way I want it to be. I don't want to be any different than this. This is what I want it to be. When I can make it a little stronger, I'll continue to work out and build some more strength in my body, from my core. I will. I can get a little stronger. And but just going to do it. I said, I'll do it just like that. Just like that, and let the results, let them come. You know, I know it's a powerful swing. There's no doubt about it. So whatever happens, it happens. We'll go with that. We'll go with that. I'm not going to try and find something else. Okay, I know I'm doing it right, and it's a powerful swing, a really good swing. Why try to search for something else at this point? Forget it. Just commit. Commit to it. So I'm committing to various aspects of it, right? Committing to a certain grip. I found this amazing grip that nobody even knows about. I'm the only one, I think, that in the world that does this grip. I don't even use these two fingers, the thumb and forefinger of my right hand. They're not even on the club at all. They're off the club entirely, not even touching the club, and not gripping the hand either. So they're not involved in the golf swing at all. Now, this is like a miracle cure. And the club stays very much on line and straight. And so the right hand can't twist it offline, overpower and twist it somehow. Like a miracle cure. So I'm getting more and more comfortable with that. And it's giving me tremendous confidence that I'm not going to twist this club open the face, twist it, or you know, torque it in some way. So I just say, you know, that I know I'm going to hit it straight. There's no doubt about it. So I don't even worry about it. So that's huge, absolutely huge. Engaging the core, you know, that's important too. Engage the core so you know you're really stable. And so it's all just coming together. Same thing with a spiritual practice. You want to commit to this, commit. Say, I've got the answer. I know I can practice this way, and commit to it. And then you're going to feel at ease and say, you know what? I'm a pro. I'm a guru of my own practice. I'm a guru of my own golf swing right now. You know, that's how I feel. I'm the guru of my golf game. I am the guru of my golf game. You know, I've got these techniques I use, and I know they work. They're going to work for me. I don't have to do it the way that the world tells me to do it. Okay? I know I'm the guru of my own golf game. Nobody is going, you know, can overrule the guru, right? Say, no, this is how I do it. I'm the guru of my golf game. I'm not a guru of your golf game, I'm a guru of my golf game. So you need to feel like that with your practicing. You need to feel that you're the guru of your practicing. You know what to do. You know how it goes. And you can do it every single day successfully, like that. So if someone says, let's play golf, I said, yeah, no problem, you know. And I'm going to do it. I know exactly what I'm going to do out there. As far as my swing goes. Okay, for the most part, right? And I know I'll do, you know, this when I need to, you know, bump and runs, beautiful bump and runs, and, you know, chipping, I have a good idea of what I'm going to do chipping-wise. And I'll work that out a little more. I need some more practice of that. And putting-wise, I have a good idea of how I'm going to putt, what my stance is going to be, and how I can get success with that. So the elements of the game are coming together, and I know what I'm going to do. Same thing, spiritual practice. I know how to practice. So whatever happens in the world, it doesn't matter. I know how to practice. It doesn't affect me. I'm not seeking for some practice anymore at all. I'm not seeking. So this feeling is great. And you talk about confidence. Just imagine if you didn't have to seek anymore. You already knew what to do. You knew how to find success. You already know how to do it. Then you just do it. Keep putting your confidence in the bank. Keep making deposits to the bank of confidence. And just build it. You say, you know, I can't lose. I can't miss. I can't lose. Nothing can stop me. Nothing can stop me. That's how I feel. Nothing can stop me. So that's why I say putting in the hard work to groove your spiritual practice is really the wisest thing you can possibly do in your life. Quote unquote life. You're not born. Nobody's born. But we could say a lifetime of pretending to be born and have a lifetime, is the wisest thing anyone can do. Groove your spiritual practicing. Groove it and commit to it so you know You know what you're committed to. And then you're a pro. You're a pro. You're the guru of your own practice. You are a pro. Speaking of pros, the surfers are about to start the first round. It'll be like starting tomorrow, like 2 o'clock, I think, our time. The WorldSurfLeague.com. You can watch it streaming live. And it's really interesting because I discovered that there's a third break at Margaret River that they can use, and they've never used it in competition, and they're considering the first round. They may hold it there, called North Point, about 10 miles north of Margaret River. And they say it's just an incredible wave. When it's on, it's just like the pipeline almost. It's a right, just super hollow barrels, and then it barrels intensely, and then it walls up really steeply. And man, if they hold it that there, that is going to be a show. That is really going to be something. They've never done it before, but they say it's likely they will, because there's a big swell coming in and a wind conditions. Everything seems to be right, and it may be just pumping there. So I'm looking forward to that. That's quite a show, actually. Really, especially if there's barrels there. I mean, wow. So I'm, that's coming up. I believe, yeah, in about West Coast time here, about 2 o'clock West Coast time. So that'd be like 5 o'clock East Coast time. And wherever you are around the world, you could check it out. WorldSurfLeague.com. They stream it for free live. They stream it live for free. That's pretty amazing. Yeah, it's just like, wow. Very, very cool to see that. And then you can go back in the heats. They have this page where all the heats are highlighted, the videos highlighted. You can go to every highlight of the heat, every wave ridden, the scores they got, every thing that happened, and you can just click on it and you can go in there instantly. That is quite astonishing, the technology that they use there. Very, very effective. So we'll see what happens. And Margaret River is in Western Australia, the west coast of Australia. There's not much between the east coast and the west coast of Australia. It's just the outback. It's amazing. I said, well, isn't there something out there? Come on. Can't we build this, you know, nice city out in the outback? It's all this territory there. Did you know that from northern Queensland down to New South Wales, southern Australia, it's like over 5,500 miles of coastline. 5,500 miles. And there's surf spots all along there. I mean, Australia is just a surf crazy place. I don't think there's any place, any country in the world that's quite as surf crazy as Australia. Nothing. I don't think anything comes close, because everyone lives on the coast, and there's waves everywhere. So it's just bad. They can always find waves. What are you going to do? They just go surfing. Australians are, you know, it's got to be the surf capital of the world, for sure. I kind of envy them a little bit that they're able to just, they say if the spot you're on is crowded, just drive them an hour north or south, and you'll find a place all to yourself. It's just, can't miss in Australia. Pretty cool place. Never been there. I've never been anywhere, actually. Except when I was a kid, one time to Europe. But other than that, no. That's okay. I've been grooving my practice for these times. These times, you want to have your practice grooved for these times. You don't want to be reading spiritual books. You don't want to be seeking. You do not. That's called spirituality. And you want to stay away from spirituality for the most part. But all these people are seeking. They don't have a practice. They don't have a grooved practice. They're floundering. You know, maybe it's this. Oh. And it's really, I could go on and on about spirituality. But practicing is way better than spirituality. It's way beyond it. Way beyond it. What you see directly as the brilliant clarity of your own mind, it makes spirituality look like aimless chatter. Yeah, it really does. It's way beyond it. As Rama said, all spiritual talk is just talk. All heart talk is just talk. That's not it at all, he says. He says practice is it. The Dharma kings always say your practice is what is it. You have to groove your practice. You have to be with steady determination. You must practice. They all say that. And yet, for some reason, we don't listen to that part of them. Then we say, Ramana says this quote. Oh, that's a nice quote from Ramana. That's spirituality. That's not practice. Now, in spirituality can keep your enthusiasm going. So it's not like there's no role at all for it. I mean, it's not like you have to completely shut yourself off from it. But, you know, that's just enduring, that's just for breaks between your practicing is all it's good for. You know, sure, in between your practicing, you might want to stay in touch with pictures of great saints and their sayings and stuff, just to keep the momentum going and make sure, you know, but that's just small potatoes. It's just small potatoes between your practicing. It's practicing that's where it's at, and nothing else is where it's at. That's it. That's it. I told my PGA pro, I said, you know, I've just taken a couple years off just to get in shape. I told him 1 year, and he said, you know, he said, I absolutely love that idea. He said, that's fantastic you're doing that. He said, you know, I think I'm going to do that at some point in my life. I'm going to do the same thing. Just take a year off and just recalibrate everything. He said, I think, you know, everybody should do that. That's really, really wise what you're doing. That's what he told me. I said, holy cow, that's pretty good advice. He didn't say, go practice, go play. He says, keep working out, get in great shape, you know, and recalibrate. That's really, really wise what you're doing. Right from a PGA pro. How about that? That helped me out. I said, holy cow, he gets it. That's important. He says, because people burn out. You know, he says, they burn out, they quit, they get out of shape. And he said, if you really love golf, you'll be willing to spend a year or two just reconnecting with the game in terms of your fitness and your ability and up it, make sure it's really, really high, and then you'll love it, the game again. But you can fall out of love with the game because you lose your confidence. It's exactly what happens. You've got to be very careful about not losing your confidence. Same with spiritual practicing. Make sure you keep your confidence. Don't push yourself too quickly. You know, don't get greedy. Don't get greedy. And don't risk the success you just had. Don't double down. It's so important to hear that. And this way you say, you stay positive. You keep saying, wow, I'm having so much success and I'm not having any failures at all. This is wonderful. You don't want a bunch of failures on the path, okay? Yeah, people talk about failures. Oh, that's great. You learn from it. No, you burn out from it. You burn out from it. It's like golf saying, oh, I really had a tough round today, you know, but I learned a lot from it. And, you know, if you keep having enough rounds like that, you lose 10 balls per round. At some point, you're going to say, you know what? This isn't working out for me. I think I'm, you know, I don't know. I'm not learning my lessons very good. You don't want to do that. So I told God, put me on a nice course where I don't lose a bunch of balls, and I don't want to play on tough courses anymore. I want to build my confidence, God. I don't want to tear it down. And I told him, I said, that's it. You know, this is my decision, so it's up to you to do it. It's up to you to do it, God. I've got my parameters, I've got my limitations, and I don't want to lose my confidence anymore. So you should feel that way, spiritually. You don't want to lose your confidence. You want to keep building and build. But, you know, through intense breakthroughs, you want to have breakthroughs. It's like if you do nothing, you're not building any confidence. You're actually losing it because you're saying, wow, I'm not really getting there. And you kind of stall out and, you know, you say, good morning, everyone. Here's a flower for you. Okay? And you want to do better than that. You say, good morning, everyone. I just saw, you know, what death is all about. I just had a simple, clear, total realization of what you know, where's death really come from? And what is it really about? Oh, and it's so easy to just let it go. I'm not interested in that anymore. I don't need it. That's it. I don't need that. Boom. You can just let go of death just like that. That's what you want to say in the morning. You don't want to say, here's some roses. Good morning, everybody. Here's some roses for you in the morning. You want to do better than that. Nothing wrong with some roses in the morning, but you want to do better than that. You want to say, hey, good morning. I'm on the first tee, and guess what? I just crushed it 310 yards. That's what I did. I didn't get up the first tee and say, hey, you know, I got a nice hat this morning. Look at this hat I got this morning. Hey, you're looking good this morning. Yeah, I like the way you're dressed. You know, well, anybody can dress nice on the first tee, right? You get to the first tee and you get all golf geared out and got a snazzy new hat and your shoes are clean and got a nice new driver, and you're limbering up, and guys, like, hey guys, how's it going, man? You know, yeah, what's your name? Hey, nice to meet you. And I feel great. And everyone says, oh, you look good on the first tee. And then you shank it into the bushes. And, oops, lost my ball. Let me take a mulligan. Mulligan to start the first hole. You know, that's not the way you want to start your round, is it? Already starting to cheat yourself. Yeah, right? Already starting. So, I'm not going to count that one. I wasn't quite ready. I'm going to take a mulligan. Everybody goes, oh, okay, go ahead. Yeah. No. You want to get up there. Hey, good morning, guys. You know, and just, okay, tee it up. Address the ball and just go, you know, just go right into your swing. Whack! You know, and just smash it. Just smash it. Because you know your swing, what you're going to do. Just get up, just do it, smash it 310 yards. The guys are looking, saying, oh, that was pretty cool. Good shot. Stay nice. There you go. Nice shot. Okay. Get in your cart and go find your ball. See, that's what you want to do to start the round off, right? You know, you can also be look good, but you know that's looking good is how you hit your first drive, and you know that's how you look good. And that's how it's going to go. You know, you're going to get to the second tee and repeat. And you're going to put that power swing on, and you know, it's going to hit the contact the ball, and it's going to go somewhere. It's going to go somewhere far, right? You bet it is. And you know, every swing is going to go somewhere far. And you just keep putting these power swings on it, and you're in good shape. You don't get tired, and then you know, the round goes nice and easy and smooth. Okay, guys, thanks for the round, and you know, then you're done. And then you go rest, and you say, hey, that was great. I did really great. Full stop on the wow. You know, let build the confidence. Don't go to the range and start working on something if you have a good round. No. Just don't say, hey, let me try some, see if I can fade the ball. Go to the range and start trying to fade it. And you start hitting some slices and you lose all the confidence of what you just did. No, when you do something good, that's it. You cap it right there. You cap it. Wait till next time. Wisdom. I'm finally getting wise. Yeah, really. Before, I wasn't wise enough. And then I'm starting to do a lot of stuff that's really wise. And it's pretty amazing. And I noticed it. I said, gosh, I never even thought of that before. I've been an idiot in my life. There's no question about it. I've been an idiot. But I keep working on it. I say, God, I don't want to be an idiot my whole life. You know, there's got to be some more wisdom. You know, there's got to be some wisdom somewhere. I just have to, you know, keep... that's what I want. I don't want to be an idiot. But I certainly have been an idiot. And still am, to some extent, right? But less of an idiot, for sure. Less of an idiot. But I see, you know, the world, and I see these people, I say, my God, they're idiots. I mean, they're just... And look at their lives. It's just, what? You know, they haven't grooved it. They're floundering still. They don't have a clue. They have no idea what to do. They're just waiting to die, basically. Cram a bunch of food in their face until they die. I mean, this is honestly true, is it not? Just eat, let me eat, let me eat, let me eat, let me eat, you know, and drink it. And they're just like, I hope I can do something, but, you know, I'm going to die soon. Yeah, okay, what's going to happen? And then their mind doesn't really go much beyond anything other than that. But do we really want to be so ignorant of this, what's going on here? You know, don't we want to be able to really ace the test and say, you know, I see exactly what's going on here. Absolutely. I mean, we're suffering enough here. Why can't we find out the answers here? Might as well, right? If we're going to suffer, we might as well use the suffering to help us find out what the answers really are. And then we're done. We're done. We're done with conditioned existence. Yeah, it doesn't fool us anymore at all. And peace of God is upon us. And ultimately, we are the peace of God. First, as the peace of God, we, you know, and then we're in the peace of God, and then we are the peace of God. Ultimately, something like that, we may just realize, I am the peace of God. We go from I am a spiritual being to just I am. I am a spiritual being, that's spirituality. We go to I just I am, that's it. And the WOW practice is the bridge to go from I am a spiritual being to just I am. It's that simple. Total, utter simplicity. Just I am. So we're working on that bridge, going across that bridge. The WOW practice is a bridge that, that really helps us transcend spirituality into just intrinsic simplicity. Utter, pure, intrinsic simplicity of just I am. Not I am something, just I am. Not I am a spiritual being, just I am. Nothing more than that. Recording, it's still recording, yeah. Well, I don't want to get too cold out here. I'm pretty lightly dressed. I have my Apex Yogan shirt on. I am an Apex Yogan, absolutely. I am an Apex WOW Yogan. All right, we'll see how it goes here. Every day is a new day, isn't it? Every day is a new day. So I'm just sharing my confidence with you, you know, and certainty. Yeah, you just feel like this mood of, there's a mood of certainty here. Yeah, a lot of strong certainty here, a lot of confidence here. This is effective. It really is effective. No matter what is said, even if you don't understand what's being said, if you could pick up on this mood and feeling of confidence, super helpful. Like Journey Beyond Words, for instance, transcribed by Dr. Brent Haskell from Jesus Christ. Or if you want to, Yeshua, I call him Jesus. It's fantastic. It's fabulous. Fabulous, greatest book ever written, in my opinion. That I've ever, yeah, for me, it's my number one. But what do I get from that? And I said today, I said, you know, it should be called, instead of Journey Beyond Words, you could call it A Course in Certainty. A Course in Certainty. Because what you get there is just Jesus, his certainty. Direct, confident certainty of Jesus Christ. And it just shines through the words. No matter what words he's using, it just shines through that here is someone who's talking who is absolutely certain. They have certitude. They have the certainty. There's no doubt in them at all. No doubt at all. And this is conveyed through whatever he's saying. Beyond the words is this certainty. So that's what I pick up on. That's what I felt. You feel the certainty of whoever you're listening to. You feel the certainty, and that is what really is helpful. Super, super helpful, beyond anything that anyone can say. It's just that certainty. Picture Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, for instance. You can feel her certainty, absolute certainty. Doesn't matter what anyone's saying, what she's saying, what circumstances, doesn't, none of the circumstances made a difference. She remained in this absolute certitude. Absolute effortless certitude. That's powerful. It's powerful. Doesn't matter what she says. I don't care what she says. I mean, her advice is imperfect, but it's that certainty, you know, that lies behind the advice that's really the key to it. Because we are getting familiar with certainty here, and we're losing interest in doubt. And that's how it works out. It's just we lose interest in doubt at some point. We just say, you know, I'm just really not interested in it anymore. That's all. And then our minds simply feel like the peace of God is upon us, and we can't imagine being otherwise engaged. We really can't. We can't imagine our mind being otherwise engaged other than with this certainty. But just, and then, you know, doubt like, well, I don't know. I'm just not interested. I just, what's that? I'm not, there's no interest there. We just lose interest in it. We don't defeat it by through some great technical victory or something. We ultimately just lose all interest in doubt. That's all there is to it. Because when we find out we can have certainty, that's what we want. You know, we're super attracted to it. And so when we get more and more familiar with certainty, we just lose all interest in doubt. It's like when you're young and you have some puppy love or a crush on somebody, but then you find someone that, you know, just, wow, this is it. This is it. You know, you get used to them. You completely forget about the, you know, I had a little crush on them or a little crush on them. You just totally forget about it, right? Totally forget about it. I mean, you move on to your true love, right? You're totally into your true love. So our true love is certainty. And doubt is just a silly little absurd crush we've had on something, and you know, and when we find out, hey, I can have my true love, we're going to forget all about doubt. We're going to forget all about it. We're going to lose all interest in it. Absolutely we will. That's how it's really done. Wow. Right? And that's it for this one.